those who had some general knowledge of the church can have a hard time with the Trinity. This is the only Sunday in the church year that commemorates a doctrine, the doctrine of the Trinity, rather than a person or an event. A doctrine is a particular principle, position, or teaching advocated, in this case, by the church. As important as it is, though, the concept, description, and explanation of the Trinity sometimes goes from the sublime to the ridiculous. Let's consider the ridiculous end first. We speak of the Trinity of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as being the three in one and one in three, all of the same substance, and each one equal to the other. We tried to find an illustration of this several years ago. My parents' kitchen drawer came to mind. Why? Because it is what it is. This is one fish term with three labels. All of the same substance, all of the same size. So they are equal. Each plate is equal to another. Three in one, and one in two. However, as you might suspect, this illustration lays itself out. One commentator I read relayed what one of his professors used to say. A preacher opens the Trinity Sunday sermon apologizing for her ignorance of the subject before spending the next 20 minutes demonstrating that ignorance. This is not surprising, given that it took centuries for leaders of the Christian community and movement to hash out the agreed-upon answers to questions from the inner community and from others. Was Jesus human, divine, or perfect? Is there one God, or is Christ a second God? And what of the Spirit, whose coming we celebrated last week? Such questions as these and others were raised and argued fiercely in the effort to unify the faith and the members. We know that the church still has disagreements. Disagreements about how to live out the teachings of Jesus and even about what his teachings are about some subjects. Basic questions causing turmoil in the early church had to do with God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. Who were they? What was their nature? How did they work in relation to one another? First century philosopher and theologian Philo believed that there was a distinction between God's essence or being and God's activity in the world. In the 4th century, three bishops from Cappadocia said that God has a single essence, which is incomprehensible to humankind, and has three expressions which make God known. Furthermore, they said, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are terms or expressions used to speak of activities by which God reveals God's self. Today's gospel passage includes references to these three expressions. First, Nicodemus sought Jesus under the cover of darkness, and finding him, he immediately acknowledged that it was the presence of God with Jesus that enabled him to do the signs or miracles that he was doing. By that point in the gospel, the only signs we've been told about are that he had turned water into wine and had driven the animals and money changers out of the temple. What Nicodemus calls God's presence seems to refer to God the Father, who is more vividly described in today's reading of Isaiah's vision. He saw the Lord sitting on the throne, high and lofty. His robe filled the temple, and smoke filled the house. And in this house, we know what it is like. We build the house with people. This then speaks of God the Father. Secondly, Jesus told Nicodemus that no one could see or enter the kingdom of God without being born from above, of water and what is born of flesh is flesh, he said, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. And the Spirit to which he refers is, of course, God, the Holy Spirit. Thirdly, Jesus told Nicodemus that no one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Then the passage ends with Jesus further instructing Nicodemus that God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved. The obvious reference here is to God the Son. So in this one conversation, Nicodemus and we hear about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The three ways in which we understand that God reveals God the Son. The abiding presence who oversees all, the Son who offers salvation to the world, and the Holy Spirit by whom we are reborn. From the hard work done at the Council of Nicaea in 325 and later, a creed for the Church was developed and eventually evolved into what we say and know as the Nicene Creed. At its inception, it affirmed what were considered right beliefs about God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. It continues to set forth the Church's doctrine of the Trinity. We believe in God, the Father, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, of one being with the Father. All things were made through him. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was made man. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. We worship and glorify Him, then, and has spoken through the prophet. That's just some of what we say about the Trinity in the Nicene Creed. I encourage you to pay special attention to the words when we chant them today. What's even more important is how the Trinity is thought of and works in our own lives. Sometimes it can help to think about how we pray privately. How do we begin our prayer? How do we end it? In what ways has God expressed God's self to us? One of my experiences, as I was telling the our sisters and brothers at 8 o'clock, it involves the Holy Spirit. And some of you may have heard me speak of it. I was going to a parents' weekend at my older daughter's college. And it was a Saturday morning. It was early in the morning. I was on Route 95, which I sometimes find to be hypnotic. And as I drove along, apparently my eyelids closed. I was not aware of this until I felt a breeze across my face. I had no idea how long my eyes were closed. Thanks be to God. The road was pretty clear that hour, so I had not endangered anybody else. I had not run off the road, so my car was not damaged, nor was anyone else. But I have no doubt that breeze was for me the breath of God, the Holy Spirit, opening my eyes. My guess is that many of us have experienced one or more persons of the Trinity in our lives. In our worship, the College for Purity, which is the first prayer of this liturgy, begins by addressing God as Almighty God. It goes on to ask that God cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He ends the college offering it through Christ the Lord. Thus, in this one brief prayer, we have invoked the three persons of the Trinity. Early on, in the absolution, following our confession, the bishop or priest begins again with Almighty God. This time, God's mercy and forgiveness are pronounced through Jesus Christ. The bishop or priest asks that we be strengthened in all goodness and that the power of the Holy Spirit keep us in eternal life. Here is another prayer that invokes the Trinity. And here are others. Clearly, it is more than an ancient doctrine for the Church. What's been said about the Trinity this morning has been, I hope, mostly between the sublime and the ridiculous. For the ridiculous end is the illustration of my fish turner. For the sublime end is simply to say that the Holy Trinity our relationships with one another, and with the triune God. Holy, holy.